Good morning, this is Radio Good News. The goal of this program is to draw all people to the love of Jesus Christ. I want everyone to know and experience the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Those are key to a Holy Spirit-filled and successful Christian life. I'll focus on God's love because God's love is wonderful. I'm John Thornton. I'll be reading from the Bible, the New Revised Standard Version, because that's God's word to us in our language. Let's begin today with Psalm number 8. O Lord, our sovereign, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens, out of the mouths of babes and infants. You have founded a bulwark because of your foes, to silence the enemy and the avenger. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars that you have established, what are human beings that you are mindful of them, mortals that you care for them? Yet you have made them a little lower than God and crowned them with glory and honor. You have given them dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under their feet, all sheep and oxen, and also the beasts of the field, the birds of the air and the fish of the sea, whatever passes along the paths of the sea. O Lord, our sovereign, how majestic is your name in all the earth. And those are God's words from Psalm number 8. Our musical guest today is Glad.
Rock of ages left for me, let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy wound at side that flow be of sin the double cure, save from wrath and take me pure. All the labors of my hands could not meet thy lost demand. Could my zeal no respite know? Could my tears forever flow? All for sin could not atone. Thou must save, and thou I cry out for grace.
Oh, foul, I to the fountain fly.
Wash me, Savior, or I die.
While I draw this fleeting breath, when my eyes will close in death,
that's been Glad, and we'll hear from Glad again at the end of the program today. Turn with me to the book of Genesis, if you have your Bibles, Genesis chapter 9, verses 18 through 29. The sons of Noah who went out of the ark were Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Ham was the father of Canaan. These three were the sons of Noah, and from these the whole earth was peopled. Noah, a man of the soil, was the first to plant a vineyard. He drank some of the wine and became drunk, and he lay uncovered in his tent. And Ham, the father of Canaan, saw the nakedness of his father and told his two brothers outside. Then Shem and Japheth took a garment, laid it on both their shoulders, and walked backward and covered the nakedness of their father. And their faces were turned away, and they did not see their father's nakedness. When Noah awoke from his wine and knew what his youngest son had done to him, he said, "Cursed be Canaan, lowest of slaves he shall be to his brothers." He also said, "Blessed by the Lord my God be Shem, and let Canaan be a slave. May God make space for Japheth, and let him live in the tents of Shem, and let Canaan be a slave." After the flood, Noah lived 350 years. All the days of Noah were 950 years, and he died. Those are God's words from the book of Genesis, chapter 9, verses 18 through 29. Recently, Thomas Jefferson, one of the founding fathers of the United States of America, has been in the news. Some people look to our founding fathers and think that they're somehow without problems, they're stainless or perfect. But through DNA testing, it has been proven that Thomas Jefferson sexually exploited at least one of his female slaves. It's not really surprising, for slavery itself is a horrible and wicked sin. And this is especially true of the abomination of American slavery from the 1500s or so up till the Civil War. As Americans, we should be ashamed of the sins of slavery. And we owe people in Africa, like the people of Ghana, an apology. For Christians, slavery has been forever put away by the final and overriding teachings found in the New Testament. For slavery is based on kidnapping. Probably the clearest evidence of slavery being a sin is found in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 9 through 11, which reads, "This means understanding that the law is laid down not for the innocent, but for the lawless and disobedient, for the godless and sinful, for the holy, unholy, and profane, for those who kill their father or mother, for murderers, fornicators, sodomites, slave traders, liars, perjurers, and whatever else is contrary to the sound teaching that conforms to the glorious gospel of the blessed God." Now, did you hear God's word? Yes, God tells us that slavery is a sin of the same magnitude as murder, sexual perversion, and lying. So Thomas Jefferson was not without sins. But why did slavery happen? Well, the answer is very complex. But part of the answer is because of a faulty understanding and reading of our passage in Genesis. Some people did ignore the clear teachings of the New Testament and supported slavery by misunderstanding Noah's sin and cursing. So let's revisit drunken Noah and his unholy cursing and see just where the abomination of slavery started. You know, some people, in addition to the founding fathers, think that the Bible heroes are sort of like stained glass. They are heroes that look good whenever the sun shines, heroes with no spots or blemishes. But that view is wrong. Other people say something like, "Well, the Bible's just a book of invented myths or legends." But they're wrong too. Just look at Noah. For why would people invent a legend about Noah and put such a drunken hero in the center of the legend? No one would invent such a legend. One would invent a perfect hero. But the truth is that the Bible is a record of real-life people, real-life stories of historical people, people who lived and breathed under the same sky as you and I. Our modern world's violence is bad, but it just does not compare to Noah's world. Even the evils of dictatorships in the 20th century do not really compare to Noah's world. About the only place we surpass Noah's world of violence is in our wicked building of nuclear bombs. Yes, our violence is now to the point where a few people could abort the whole of humanity using the evil weapons of nuclear destruction. Vicious acts of violence, or even hate-mongering extremists, as horrible and awful as they are, all those things pale in comparison to the world that Noah lived in. For God said that Noah's world was corrupt and filled with violence. The evils of that time were so horrible that God was angry and sorry that he had made humanity. The violence and evil was so horrible that God regretted he had ever created people. But in that world was a man named Noah, a man that God said was blameless among the people of his time. He was righteous compared to the rest of the people in his generation. Noah was not perfect. He still suffered from original sin, as we all do. Noah was comparatively righteous in God's sight as viewed against the evil wickedness of his generation. God called Noah and said that he was to build a big boat. God told Noah to build an ark to save himself and all of his family. Noah was about 500 years old at that time. God gave Noah detailed instructions on how to build the ark. And when Noah was about 600 years old, the rains came. God had given Noah the time to build the ark. It may have been 100 years that God had waited to dispense judgment. Noah and his wife and his sons, Ham, Shem, and Japheth, and their wives, they finished the ark. Then the animals were gathered, some by pairs and some by sevens. Noah's ark was actually the very first ecological preservation project. It was all orchestrated by God. Then the rain came. It rained and rained. But not only did it rain and rain, but the earth also opened up and the water rushed out and covered the land. Noah and his family and all the animals were safe in the ark. The violent people were washed away in the flood. And all that was left was the small family and the many, many animals. Have you imagined what happened inside the ark during those many months? I'm sure that this was no carnival cruise ship. No Kathy Lee Gifford out singing and dancing on the decks. No rumba band playing on the Lido deck dance floor. No hot and cold running water. No catered food service. No lights. Except maybe for some carefully tended fires on that wooden vessel. It was very, very difficult. And think of the smell. All those animals together in one confined place. It must have been cold, dark, and terrible. So the water goes down, and eventually, nearly a year after the rain started, the ark comes to rest on the mountains of Ararat. When the ground dries out, Noah and his family step out and the animals go forth to repopulate the earth. God comes to Noah and gives the promise of the rainbow. In this promise, God affirms that humanity has value. People are created in God's own image. And God will look out and see humanity through the rainbow. God sees humanity through the beauty of his rainbow, and God will remember his promise to never flood the earth with water again. God promised never to destroy the earth in a flood again, and the rainbow reminds us and God of that promise. Indeed, Noah's faith lived up to that great and horrible crisis. Noah was a righteous man, and he saved the world by his righteous answer to God's call. Consider, would you answer God's call and work for 100 years on what to all practical purposes looked like a farce? Indeed, Noah was a man of faith, and his righteousness was shown by his work. Noah should be forever remembered as a man of great faith. Now, if this were the end of Noah's story, we could call him a stained glass saint, a saint that looked good whenever the sun shines. But it's not the end of the story, for God has told us more about Noah. For the Bible does not tell us myths and lies about invented heroes, but instead the Bible tells us real stories. For we also know about Noah's vineyard. Noah planted a vineyard and harvested the grapes. He then made wine and drank the wine. Noah got drunk. Noah was so drunk that he fell down naked in his tent. He was passed out on the floor of his tent naked. We do not know why Noah was drunk. Perhaps it was just an accident? Maybe Noah was just ignorant and he didn't know what was happening. Maybe Noah had been in some weird situation where it was not his fault that he got drunk. Could it be there was no alcoholic wine prior to the flood? Hardly. Some people have made speculative fanciful, ridiculous, and bizarre ways to rationalize Noah's sin, but they all fall apart when compared to God's true words in the Bible, for Noah sinned. Noah knew how to make wine. Noah knew all about the process for making alcoholic wine. He knew about the wine, he planted the grapevines and grew the grapes and harvested the grapes, and Noah got drunk. So drunk he was passed out naked in his tent. Perhaps Noah had trouble living in a calm period. Perhaps Noah was better during a crisis. I've known people like that. Maybe now that things had settled down, the great Captain Noah could not handle the calm. Remember, he had spent 100 years overseeing the building of the ark. He's probably abused, tormented, and ridiculed by his neighbors. And then more months alone in the ship on the great flood. Perhaps Noah did not know what to do during the calm time. Whatever the reason for Noah's drunkenness, he was drunk. Ham then must have stumbled into the tent looking for his dad, but instead he found a passed out drunk. It's possible that Canaan, Noah's grandson, was with his dad Ham when they found the great father Noah drunk and naked in his tent. But is this just what happened long, long ago? No. When we look out over our society, far too many little children are going without love, nurturance, compassion, because one parent or maybe even both parents have chemical dependency. Yes, Noah's type sin is still with us far too much today. Ham found his father drunk. He goes outside and tells his brothers about it. The brothers come into the tent and they make a big production number out of backing in and covering up the drunk sailor Noah. But no one can hide sin from God. Isaiah 59:6 reads, "Their webs cannot serve as clothing. They cannot cover themselves with what they make. Their works are works of iniquity, and deeds of violence are in their hands." And Jeremiah 23:24 reads, "Who can hide in secret places so that I cannot see them, says the Lord? Do I not fill heaven and earth, says the Lord?" And again, God tells us in Hebrews 4:13, "And before him no creature is hidden, but all are naked and laid bare to the eyes of the one to whom we must render an account." Yes, Noah's sons are wrong to attempt to hide their father's sin. And soon, Noah wakes up from his wine. He has what people call a hangover. He comes out of a drunken slumber, cursing and swearing. Some people have tried to blame Ham and Canaan for what happened. But Ham only saw his father's sin and told his brothers. Canaan did nothing wrong. The Bible says he saw Noah, Ham saw Noah drunk, passed out drunk in his tent, and he told his brothers. The only thing he really did wrong was he broke the code of silence in that dysfunctional family. And Canaan, the grandson, did nothing wrong. But then Ham and Canaan received the blame from drunken Noah. In Noah's unrighteous cursing, he does not attack Ham, the man who discovered his drunken nakedness, but instead attacks Ham's son, the innocent boy Canaan. Canaan is innocent, yet he's cursed and yelled at. Do you know a worse way to hurt people than to attack and yell at their children? Noah does not attack Ham, maybe because Ham's big enough to fight back. Noah swears at his grandchild. He proves that he's not a stained glass saint. He curses his grandson, but he praises his other two sons, the ones who hide his sin. He plays favorites with his children and wants to keep his own sins under wraps. He likes the fact that two of his sons will join in his denial of sin by covering it up. Do you know anyone like that? For we all are sinners. I'm a sinner and so are you. And even Thomas Jefferson and all the founding fathers of the United States were sinners. And remember, Noah's cursing here is not from God. Noah just flies off the handle and uses religious language to swear. Think about it. Nearly all foul language is one of two kinds, either using religious language inappropriately or using vile gutter language for sex. Noah is out of line for cursing his grandson. He's sinning. He's no stained glass saint. So after Noah curses Canaan, Ham takes his son Canaan and flees away. Ham takes his family away and never ever returns. Ham protects his son Canaan by fleeing from the abuse that Noah's about to unheap upon them. Now here is where some people have been deluded and have invented the idea that Ham and Canaan's skin color was changed. But that's not in the Bible. It's an invention of a sick, racist mind looking for an excuse for slavery. Noah is not the only person in the Bible who sinned. Noah stands along with all the rest of us except for Jesus Christ, our Master and Messiah. Adam and Eve started it all by sinning. Moses was a murderer. David was a man after God's own heart, but he had a strong tendency toward adultery and murder. Solomon was filled with divine wisdom, yet had 700 wives and 300 concubines. Lots of sin there. And Peter denied Jesus Christ 3 times, but was counted as the leader of the apostles. Paul ended up being a great evangelist, but when he was Saul, he had been a murderer of people, Christians like Stephen. We don't encourage anyone to follow the sins of these people because they're not perfect. So we must label Noah's drunken cursing as sin. So what do we make of the Noah story, which ends on such a tragic note? Well, we see that Noah lived for many more years, but he never sought out his son or his grandson to seek their forgiveness. Ham and Cana are blood relatives to Noah, yet Noah never seeks them out. It seems Noah died a bitter man with a broken family. For there are no heroes to model our lives on in this story. The whole family's messed up, a lot like families today. Noah's a drunk who curses his grandson. The wives are absent from the story. Are they hiding from Noah's drunken rage? Shem and Japheth try to hide their father's sin and seem to live in denial. They excuse their father's sin, and Ham and Canaan run away. There's no heroes. Noah was about to unleash abuse on his grandson as a slave. But, you know, Ham and Canaan also sin. When they run away, they reject everything that Noah has done and they turn away from God. Ham's children go on to become the pagan Canaanites who rejected most of God's ways. Yes, there are no heroes in this story. Remember, we must not blame the wine. The biblical record, God's inspired word, tells us that all of the apostles drank wine at the Last Supper. Jesus, our Master and Messiah, drank alcoholic wine, yet he never sinned. Paul told Timothy to use wine for his stomach, so the wine in and of itself is not the problem. The drunkenness is the sin. We need to recognize that drunkenness is sin. We must reject drunkenness and help people to control their drinking. We must try to live in love and assist those who are struggling with this habitual sin. Noah's time did not have groups such as Alcoholics Anonymous. Noah's time did not have groups to assist families where alcohol is destroying the family. We as Christians need to reject drunkenness and help people to live without being drunk or chemically dependent. Ham ran away from the problems. He abandoned the solution to the problem. For only in God is there hope. Jesus Christ is where the hope is. For we cannot hide, ignore, or run away from our sins. God can deliver us from our sins through faith in Jesus Christ. We can't be like Shem and Japheth who just want to cover it up and ignore sin. We must love other people, gently, supportively helping them to stop sinning. We help them out of love. God does not expect you to be a perfect stained glass saint. You know, stained glass has a nasty habit of breaking under stress. That's what happened to Noah. God does want you to be a real person of faith, not a stained glass invented hero. Real people of faith will sometimes fall. And when we fall, others probably will get hurt. For sin always seeks to destroy. When Noah fell, it was not because of a great crisis. Noah fell because of drunkenness and his own stupid cursing and his stubborn refusal to seek forgiveness. Because of his sin, his family was broken up. Is that what will happen to you? The true hope lies in the fact that God knows that none of us are stained glass saints. None of us are perfect. David sinned and repented. Solomon sinned and repented. Mary Magdalene sinned and repented. Peter sinned and repented. God wants us to repent from our sins. Jesus offers us forgiveness For Jesus loves us even though we're not perfect. God tells us to strive toward perfection, striving to take every thought captive to Christ. That is our goal. And God seeks to have us confess to Him when we sin. For when we confess our sins, Jesus is faithful and just, and Jesus will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But we must ask for God to forgive our sins. And together, we must hold each other in loving accountability. James 5:16 tells us, "Therefore, confess your sins to one another, so that you can be healed. The prayer of the righteous is powerful and effective." We can never make it under our own power. We can never get rid of our sins by our own work. We can only turn our sins over to Jesus Christ, our loving Master and Messiah, the Prince of Peace, and He can wash us clean from our sins. That's how we overcome the evil that we see in the world, starting in our own lives, being personally responsible for our sins, confessing them to God and seeking forgiveness. And then through prayer, we can do mighty and powerful things. For the prayer of the righteous is powerful and effective because God intervenes. Indeed, thanks be to God for His love in that while we were still sinners, Christ reconciled us to God. So don't expect anyone to be a perfect stained glass saint, not Thomas Jefferson, not Noah, not me at all. I'm a terrible sinner. But look to Jesus Christ, the only one who has never sinned, for Jesus loves you. I'm John Thornton. Thanks very much for tuning into Radio Good News. I encourage you to seek out a church family where you can worship, be encouraged, and give up habitual sins like drunkenness or chemical addiction. For this area offers many fine Bible-believing and teaching churches of various denominations. You can write to me, and I appreciate your notes and cards. Write to me at Radio Good News, P.O. Box 1722, Sioux Falls, South Dakota 57101. May you richly know the blessings of the God who was, the God who is, and the God who is to come again. And always remember, the Bible tells us that love is patient, love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. Love does not insist on its own way. Love is not irritable or resentful. Love does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. Love never ends because God is love. Faith, hope, and charity abide. So, remember, Jesus Christ loves you. So love the Lord your God with all your heart, strength, soul, and mind. And love your neighbors, your families, and even your enemies as yourselves. We'll finish today with Glad.
Cheers.